Professor Dave here, let's talk about drugs.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We have all heard of drugs before. Whether the word brings up images of aspirin bottles or marijuana leaves, a drug is defined as any substance that has a physiological effect when introduced into the body. Let's discuss this concept in two parts. Later, we will discuss drugs in the pharmaceutical or medicinal context. But for now, let's tackle some of the more common ones everyone has heard of. For many people, the word drug makes them think first of narcotics. A narcotic is generally a substance that produces a numbing or dulling effect, and many of these substances are illegal. The first narcotic discovered was opium, which is the dried sap of the poppy plant, popularly used in opium dens of the past. In actuality, opium is comprised of a number of alkaloids, which are named as such because of their basicity that is due to the presence of amino groups. Morphine was the first of these alkaloids to be isolated, and it was immediately observed to be useful as an analgesic, which is another term for a painkiller. It was also observed to produce various psychological responses, like euphoria, and the potential for crippling addiction. How does morphine work? Morphine acts as an opioid receptor agonist. That means that it binds to opioid receptors found on cells in the central nervous system and mimics the role of endorphins, which are a natural way that the body doles out pain relief. So it's like a forced physiological response. Once morphine was introduced into medicine at the beginning of the 20th century, heroin was almost immediately derived from it. Heroin is almost the same as morphine, although instead of these two hydroxyls, there are two ester groups. Heroin is a more potent narcotic than morphine and even more addictive. Another drug that was isolated from a plant is cocaine, which was found in the leaves of the South American coca bush. Cocaine is another alkaloid, and it first found medical application as an anesthetic. Its use was immediately popularized by Sigmund Freud, the founder of psychoanalysis, who used it regularly. Cocaine essentially operates as a reuptake inhibitor, which causes accumulation of the neurotransmitters dopamine, serotonin, and norepinephrine in the synaptic cleft. This accumulation is responsible for the feelings of euphoria associated with the drug. Cocaine does not have physical withdrawal symptoms, but it is nonetheless quite psychologically addictive due to the reward pathway that it activates. Not all alkaloid narcotics are illegal. Caffeine is also an alkaloid, and it is the world's most widely consumed psychoactive drug, found in coffee beans. It operates both by stimulating portions of the nervous system and by inhibiting receptors that typically bind with adenosine to produce drowsiness. So the inhibition of this mechanism helps generate the alertness associated with caffeinated beverages. Nicotine is another alkaloid, which is found in the tobacco plant. It works by binding to acetylcholine receptors in the brain, increasing the levels of certain neurotransmitters. However, nicotine is highly toxic, with a lethal dose for a human being about 50 milligrams. Tetrahydrocannabinol, or THC, is found in the marijuana plant and is classified as a cannabinoid. This molecule operates as an agonist for cannabinoid receptors located in the nervous system and immune system. Binding to these receptors will in turn inhibit adenylate cyclase, which means a reduction in the concentration of C-AMP, which results in a variety of psychological effects. Because psychological effects include the alteration of cognition and perception, this drug is classified as a psychedelic drug. Other psychedelic drugs include psilocybin, LSD, mescaline, and DMT, which predominantly operate by activating serotonin receptors. A key feature that is common to many of these molecules is the phenylethylamine functional group. This structural fragment appears to be crucial in modifying the way nerve cells carry messages to the brain. Mixed opinions exist about all of the drugs we have discussed, and there is some controversy over the benefits and harms associated with each of them. In the end, much of that discussion goes beyond the scope of biochemistry. But what does not go beyond biochemistry is their mechanism of action. Every drug exhibits a particular bioactivity because of its shape and where it fits in the body. By now, after learning quite a bit about enzymes and receptors, we should be able to view the cellular landscape within our bodies as a collection of nooks and crannies where small molecules can fit. And certain molecules do indeed fit into these nooks and crannies that elicit very specific biochemical responses. It is important to understand drugs on this fundamental level, because although an assessment of how they affect the human experience is more in the domain of psychology or possibly even philosophy, this can always be reduced to interactions between small molecules. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.